A very, very good morning, Comrade Yechuri. We have with us General Secretary of the CPIM, Comrade Sitaram Yechuri, a veteran parliamentarian, leader of the Communist Party, and of course, a spokesperson for the marginalized. Comrade Yechuri, the General Secretary of CPIM is mentioned directly or indirectly in the charge sheet for the Delhi riots. I won't even call it riots. It was Delhi communal violence, which became targeted almost like a pogrom in the latter phases. What does this mean? What does this mean about what this regime plans to do?
Well, I mean, it's been very clear. This is an orchestrated construction. What they are charging me is saying that I've given a speech against the CAA, NRC, NPR, and that I mean, according to some statement made by somebody, some Fatima, that which is unsigned, which in garbled language. From there, they have drawn out the thing saying that I instigated the Muslims to actually go into action, which has caused this riots. Now, anti-CAA, anti-NRC, anti-NPR, I am continue to be. I think this is anti-Indian constitution. And I'll continue to defend the constitution. This is not only my right to speak, but it is also my duty. And I've spoken this not only where they are telling me I spoke somewhere near Jafarabad in Delhi, but I've spoken about this all over the country to a large number of people. And I think standing up to defending our constitution is a very, very patriotic act.
Because a large number of petitions are being filed, so it's, the registry will take its own time in terms of the sequence or the line that is waiting. So see, as CPIM, I'll file the challenge petition before the courts, and we hope that basic point is that it is essentially anti-constitution. It's not only unconstitutional, but it's anti-constitutional.
They want to show that as an anti-national act. Now, a position on the CAA, NRC, NPR, linking it up with the communal violence in Delhi. And they want to link it up because this is the orchestration they want to show. In that communal violence in Delhi, like you mentioned, it was targeted. 53 people died. No charge sheet on these murders. We've known leaders of the BJP, a cabinet minister. Their known leaders in Delhi have given incendiary hate speeches, which provoked, and there was virtually a timetable announced that till Donald Trump is in India, they will not embark on anything else. The moment he leaves, it'll begin, and that's what happened. It's all there. Evidence is all there. Nothing about that. This is the orchestration that they are doing of linking up the anti-CAA peaceful protests with the communal violence in Delhi, which has been orchestrated by the ruling party members. And that is very clear. So the Delhi police is functioning directly, as it always has been, directly under the Union Home Ministry. So what is being done is at the direction of the central government and the Union Home Ministry.
Actually, that's a very good point, Comrade Yechuri, because on March 12th, in the speech in Parliament, in the Lok Sabha, the Home Minister very clearly laid out the chronology of the Delhi violence. Yeah. And he actually patted the Delhi police on its back, despite the fact that the Delhi police was being criticized for a kind of complicity, not acting, one-sided action, etc. But the Home Minister in Parliament says that the chronology is clear. We are seeing Delhi having protests from the December. We see the conspiracy behind the protest, and the Delhi police has done its job in a very, very good way.
ये 20 लाख लोगों के बीच में जो दंगा हो रहा था, इसको दिल्ली में स्प्रेड नहीं होने देना ये बहुत बड़ी जिम्मेदारी थी, और मैं मानता हूँ कि इसको बहुत अच्छे तरीके से दिल्ली पुलिस ने निभाया है.
So, in fact, the fact that it's a politically driven probe is a matter of parliamentary record. Because on March 12th, the Home Minister says this in Parliament. After that, the Lieutenant Governor takes a lot of interest, personal interest, in which lawyers are appointed, which prosecutors are appointed or not appointed. The Solicitor General of this government, who is there in any such politically motivated case as we've seen, appears in all the cases related to the Delhi violence. And the tragedy is that the COVID-19 pandemic period, which ought to have been used to direct full energies to overcome the pandemic, come to the help of migrant workers, those who are daily wage earners, improve our health infrastructure. Instead of that, the lockdown period where people are insecure and are afraid is being misused by this regime to actually, the figure is 1,340 or 1,430 people arrested by the Delhi police, misusing the lockdown and the pandemic. So
it's very obvious, no? It's a political agenda. Nothing to do with law and order, nothing to do with investigating any violence.
Right.
It's a political agenda that is being pursued.
The Delhi Commissioner's statement yesterday clarifying that neither you nor Ms. Jayati Ghosh nor Yogendra Yadav have been actually named, is that a backtracking or is it just a temporary?
You see, you understand, first of all, this is an unsigned statement.
Correct.
Second of all, these are all educated young women.
Yeah.
To expect them to write such language, I cannot believe.
Yeah.
So there's doubt also in its authenticity and its genuineness. Now, this is passed off as the information. This is the feeler they send. This is their methodology.
Yeah.
And the methodology is that this is all these people have been named. This will be taken to the court. And then the court will then say, first, it has to be admissible.
Yeah.
Correct. Any confession to a police is not admissible. Has to be a confession to the court.
Yeah.
So the court will have to insist on it. But we'll have to wait and see if the courts do that. Otherwise, the logic has been what? Anybody named in the charge sheet. Frame charges against them.
Yeah.
And then you rope them into the whole action. That's what happened with the Bhima Koregaon cases.
Yeah.
That is what happened with Harsh Mandar in Delhi. That is what is happening with a lot of other people that we see. So this is a clear-cut the message that is being given. Either you accept my political project of the RSS conception of a Hindutva Rashtra in India, not the secular democratic constitution. Or else, you are virtually the enemy of the state. Remember the film in our childhood which we saw? The enemy of the state. Yeah. And that is the clear message.
Comrade Yechuri, the political opposition has been apprised of this witch hunt from virtually April onwards. Do you think that every opportunity has been used by the political opposition to call out the Delhi police and even the Uttar Pradesh police where a similar witch hunt is being carried on?
Unfortunately, a lot more needs to be done. And that is why, where we are appealing to them. We tried even during the lockdown. The left parties were, of course, together. We've had some protest actions on this issue together as the left. And on one or two occasions, some other parties also joined us. But this has to be much larger and widened much more. That is why we are making the efforts to try and bring together, now that the parliament session is here, though very truncated, where large many number of MPs have not been able to come.
Correct.
And therefore, I don't know. They'll just use this as the the stamp to get approval to all the anti-Indian interest and anti-people ordinances, 11 of them that they moved during the lockdown period, convert them into law. Well, that's a different agenda that we'll have to fight in a different way, and we must fight.
You rightly said that this issue, we have a truncated parliament, questionnaire has been removed. There's an attempt not even to allow legitimate questions from the opposition.
Yes, correct.
Will this issue of the latest witch hunt, the last ring of the witch hunt where yourself, Apurvananji, others, Yogin Yadavji, etc. are being named, will this matter be raised in parliament by the left?
Well, already notices have been given in both the houses. Notices have been given in both the houses to suspend all business and discuss this issue.
Right.
And in Rajya Sabha, it was also mentioned in the notice that I've been the leader of my group and the left in the Rajya Sabha for 12 years or so.
Right.
And that particular reference also says that, I mean, my role in the parliament itself. So all that has been done, but whether the chairman will accept it, whether the speaker will accept it, that will have to be seen. But it has already been raised.
A few months back, you told Sabrang India that basically parliamentary democracy is being used to quash parliament because no opposition voices are being allowed, no norms are being followed. And what is the way out for this? I mean, what is the way out when we are seeing the stranglehold on the functioning of parliament? We are seeing the misuse of the law and order enforcement agencies and the quelling of dissent. What is the way forward? I mean, what do we tell people? How do you move forward?
The way forward is only to strengthen popular resistance. And this has to be done at all levels. Use whatever available parliamentary forums that you have. Utilize them, however truncated they may have become. But we need to utilize all this, and as well as build up people's protests and people's resistance to what is happening. Because it's not only the parliament that is being, you know, truncated. Somebody has defined it, and I think a very, very good definition that they've given. In these sort of totalitarian regimes, what's happening, whether it's under Trump in the USA, whether Bolsonaro in Brazil, whether Erdogan in Turkey, and now in India, what we have is being defined as something called the phantom democracy.
Okay.
You have a pretense of democracy, but it's a phantom. I mean, in the sense, it's not real. And that democratic pretense is maintained to destroy democracy. And that is the parliament to begin with, then the judiciary, then the election commission, then the enforcement agencies, like you said, and utilizing the law and order machinery as an arm of the political arm of the government. Now, this is a very, very serious undermining of the entire Indian constitutional order that we are seeing today. And this is where people's resistance, like we resisted the emergency, which was the people's resistance. That people's resistance has to be built up. And that is what we are all attempting to do.
You mentioned the emergency. And there's been a lot of parallels drawn by many, many people, writers, academics, activists, about that being a declared emergency and this being an undeclared emergency.
That's right.
You yourself were one of the stalwart student leaders who emerged and fought the emergency, etc. What do you see as the similarities and what are the differences?
Well, the similarities is curtailment of your democratic rights, curtailment of civil liberties. That was happening officially under internal emergency then in the 70s. Now it is happening without being declared. That is correct. Now, the difference is, even during the emergency, you still had the semblance of certain constitutional authorities which had their independence. And it is that independence that is being eroded today, and therefore it is much more dangerous. The judiciary, we know now it's compromised during the emergency. The entire concept of what was called then as a committed judiciary. But today, there is no need of any term. That is the unfortunate thing. You're seeing it in all these, all the verdicts that have been coming out. Then you had the election commission. As I told you, all the other institutions. So the one big difference is the manner in which these constitutional authorities and their integrity and their independence, those are being destroyed. That is more pervasive now than it was during internal emergency. And that is very, very dangerous for India's future.
Is it the ideology that is at work, an ideology which you said right at the outset, is aimed towards refashioning the Indian Republic from a secular democratic republican state where the sovereignty lies with the people of the country and to change it towards a Hindutva Rashtra? Is that the project that is trying to completely pervade the institutions of governance, whether it's the judiciary, whether it's law and order? So you have people in power who don't really believe in equality and non-discrimination.
Exactly. I mean, that is the process. I mean, this is the unfolding of the metamorphosis of the character of the Indian Republic. And that is today to undermine this constitutional order, replace it with what I have said earlier, their conception of a rabidly intolerant, theocratic, a fascistic Hindutva Rashtra. That is the project that is unfolding today. And earlier we realize, the better for the country and for the people. And realization means resistance, building that resistance. That is what is most required and most urgently required.
Coming back to the Delhi probe, the Delhi police was forced to admit in July, mid-July, that out of the 1,340 people arrested, 700 plus were Muslims, 600 were Hindus, etc. But they are not telling us how many have been charged under UAPA and how many have not been charged in under normal law. Because it is UAPA, which is a draconian legislation. And I need to bring this on record that in 2008 and 2011, under the previous regime, when the draconian provisions were inserted under UAPA, inserted into UAPA, only the left had resisted this in parliament. Yeah. All the POTA and TADA, the POTA provisions were brought in. Now, an even more draconian provision was brought in 2019. And you find that the UAPA, which doesn't give bail easily, which actually allows for confessions before the police, is being used against minority student leaders and activists. And I know others have also been implicated, including yourself, indirectly. But I'm particularly mentioning young Muslim leaders because they were articulate after the unconstitutional CAA was passed. They were peaceful. They were making a stake for their citizenship and nationhood. And there seems to be a particular desire to silence that young Muslim leader, woman or man, who is able to look this regime in the eye and say that my definition of myself as a citizen is on equal terms, and I'm staking that claim. So there seems to be a very evil design in that. In Delhi and in Uttar Pradesh, we are seeing it. A mother in Karnataka, who happened to be a Muslim teacher, was also charged with sedition because she authored a play, which was the thing in the school, which was against CAA. So there seems to be a hidden design among, apart from dissent, a particular section also is under target.
Actually, if you want a Hindutva Rashtra, it is the minorities that are against, I mean, that you target. I mean, in fact, just remember, the ideologues of the RSS are on record. They've written it in their books. The three internal enemies for their conception of their Hindutva Rashtra are the Muslims, Christians, and the communists. The Muslims, Christians, and the communists are the three internal enemies of their conception of India. So that targeting is obviously there. But what I'm saying is, it's gone beyond that. It's much larger now. Whether even you can be a Hindu and you can still, when you oppose them, you're also equally targeted. And that is what is the danger. Because what it is not merely a communal program. What it is the complete destruction of the Indian constitution and the entire constitutional foundations on which independent India was built and sustained for 70 years. Now, what is the new narrative that you're watching during the last 1 year? 15th of August 1947, according to their narrative, 15th of August 1947, India achieved independence. 5th of August 2019, when Article 370 was abolished, and Kashmir, the demographic transition, the route for that has been paved. That 5th of August and the 5th of August, where the temple construction in Ayodhya began as a state function, not by any trust, as a state function, using the state machinery, the prime minister, the governor of the state, the chief minister. And that 5th of August, 2019, 2020, that is the day of India's real freedom.
Yeah.
Remember, PM Modi's first speech in Parliament. He said his task is to liberate India from bondage of the last 1,200 years. What is this dating of 1,200 years?
Yeah.
You go back to the Delhi Sultanate.
Yeah.
That is the bondage of slavery, according to them. And that is what is very obvious, what they are doing. So specific targeting is there, but it is there for every single Indian patriot. Patriot in the sense, those who believe in the current constitution and its foundational values. That is the reality that we are seeing today.
you've said the left has been taking up the opposition, left has been raising its voice. Ms. Brinda Karat also went to court on this issue. We know that. But you think that the sustained targeting, you know, now young activist Umar Khalid has been arrested last night. Now there's stories of another arrest today. We don't know where this is going to stop. In Uttar Pradesh, we've seen Darapuris, Sadaf Jafar, Mohammad Shoaib, you know, veteran activists, rickshaw pullers, property being attached in an extreme, I mean, 22 rickshaw pullers, properties being attached. I mean, it's unbelievable. And last night we are told a notification has come in Uttar Pradesh, which means I don't even need a justification for arresting you. The UP police is going to just dub you a criminal and arrest you. No process of law, no warrant. So we are seeing a combination between a completely autocratic state and a breakdown of the rule of law, worse than a banana republic. I'd like to come back to late February 2020 in Delhi again, when the speeches of Kapil Mishra were read out to the High Court at midnight. And a judge of the High Court actually asked the central government and that how can you not register an FIR? And not only Kapil Mishra, but Anurag Thakur and Parvesh Verma, they have gone scot-free, as you said, for the incendiary speeches. It's discriminatory justice at its very worst level. What is the message we are sending the citizenry?
Well, the message is very clear. If you are opposing me, you'll face the music. If you're supporting me, you'll be protected.
And hate speech?
That is the message.
And hate speech? And hate speech?
Yeah, that is part of the BJP, so he's to be protected. And the system, that's what I said, the institutions that have to uphold the rule of law, if they themselves are compromised, then what can you do? You know how the judge was transferred overnight.
Yeah.
And we all know that. We are all seeing that. So the institutions themselves are compromised. There are no checks and balances. And if there are no checks and balances, you move towards very, very intense authoritarian regimes. And that is what is happening.
Is there worse to come?
Well, that depends on us. It depends on the people's resistance. If you don't resist, versus there's still much worse to come. If you resist, then you can put a brake on this and hopefully reverse it to safeguard our republic. Then that is the process. So whether we can't sit back and say whether it's worse to come or not. Whatever has come has to be fought in the defense of our country and our constitution and our livelihoods.
Livelihoods is a very good point. You mentioned 11 completely anti-constitutional bills that are attempted to be brought in. A quick word on that, Comrade Yachuri, that the agenda to quote-unquote overturn all labor rights in the last 5 months, the agricultural prices, APMC, I mean, all these other agendas, which are clearly an agenda to transfer public resources to private capital, privatization of railways, 43,000 people committing suicide in the last 3 months, 125 million unemployed. And yet we are talking about Riya Chakravarti and we are talking about witch hunts on television. So between this agenda and also media, if you could sum up for us, what are these two different things we are seeing?
Well, that is what, even I was asked to write by a national newspaper on the first anniversary of this Modi 2.0.
Yeah.
I remember beginning that article by saying that we are living in surreal times.
Yeah.
What is the actual ground reality and what is the propaganda? Yeah. You're talking of the media. Today, what is this propaganda? I mean, why unfortunate suicide by a very promising Bollywood actor?
Yeah.
I mean, very sad. I mean, I also used to like his performances. That is being utilized to gain some political electoral gains in Bihar.
Right.
And this sort of a thing that is happening, and that is the country's attention. The Prime Minister feeding peacocks or, something else happening when, as you mentioned the statistics, when this sort of a misery is mounting of the people. Now, this agenda of these 11 ordinances is precisely that. Unbridled loot of national assets. Privatize everything, and everything is only for private profit. And you've seen even during this lockdown how India's billionaires have become richer.
Yeah.
while people's miseries has been exponentially mounting. Yeah. Now that is the reality. That is the real agenda.
That's the issue should be discussed on television. Those are the issues that should be discussed on television.
Exactly. What is the meaning of privatization of your railways? What is the meaning of handing over 6 of your airports, lucrative airports, to one particular corporate person? You are handing over and creating monopolies out of people who are your cronies. And this sort of a crony capitalism that is growing, and that requires the Indian agriculture to be decimated, destroyed, and handed over to multinational agribusiness.
Yeah.
That is the meaning of these three ordinances that have been brought. That you eliminate the Essential Commodities Act. No control on the prices. APMC, as you said, that is gone. If both of them are gone, then there's no meaning of a minimum support price to your farmer.
No.
So that protection for the farmer is gone. Already your agrarian distress is so intense that the farmers' suicides, farmer and agricultural labor suicides, in the same NCRB report, show a very, very sharp rise during this period. No, at that time, you're destroying agriculture for private profit. You're destroying the public sector for private profit. You're changing the laws for illegal mining.
Yeah.
The environment impact assessment and now the new mining laws. Destroying India's forests. And that has very, very serious environmental impact and damage as far as our country, people, economy is concerned.
And the livelihood of Adivasis and forest dwellers.
Yes, I'm coming to that. And the traditional Adivasis and forest dwellers, who were the ones who nurtured these forests. It's because of them that these forests have been nurtured and they continue to give us protection. Now, they are completely going to be uprooted, violating all laws of protection that we have given them in the parliament after a big struggle during the last decade.
Yeah.
Now all this is being done. That will generate much greater misery. And all this is happening when the COVID pandemic is raging in the country.
Raging. There's no.
Exactly. You are today literally, Mr. Prime Minister Modi's dream of being the world leader. We are the leader of the world in having highest number of positive cases every day. Now, this agenda going on, henceforth, these ordinances, you see, if the possibility of any resistance, working class, their rights, their democratic rights, you abolish them. And use this pandemic situation to say section 144, not more than 4 people allowed. So paralyze people and their protests, but the government continues the implementation of its own agenda. That is today India's tragedy. Instead of single-mindedly focusing on combating the pandemic and providing relief to the people, what we are seeing is people being left to fend for themselves by this government. And then the government is busy implementing its own agenda. Now, this is the serious problem and challenge that we'll have to all together rise to meet.
Thank you, Comrade Yechury. That was a very, very extensive conversation. Finally, is Comrade Yechury himself worried about the charge sheet and the probe personally? Is there any worry?
What is there to worry? I mean, this is all part of the... I mean, if I were to worry, I wouldn't be where I am.
Yeah.
That is so very obvious. We are not going to be, sir. I mean, if they think that they're going to cow us down, no, that's not going to happen.
And a message to those youngsters and young families who've been incarcerated for the last 5 months, because there's a lot of despair.
Yeah, there is despair, but this is the time when my sincere, heartfelt solidarity, and that solidarity means that we all have to join together to strengthen the resistance. And that is what is required. And that is what we need to save India today so that we can change it for a better India tomorrow.
Thank you so much. And all the best. Thank you very, very much.